An ant is pretty stupid. It doesn't have much of a brain, no will, no plan. And yet, many ants together are smart. An ant colony can construct complex structures. Some colonies keep farms of fungi, others take care of cattle.
I don't know if it's fair to call an ant stupid, you know what I mean? I'd like to ponder on that a bit more, but we'll continue.
They can wage war or defend themselves. How is this possible? How can a bunch of stupid things do smart things together? This phenomenon...
I mean, just take a look at humans, right? I don't think we're actually intelligent at all. I mean, I'm sure we look almost as close to chimpanzees as ants look to chimpanzees to aliens out there. And I have no doubt about this. We are way too arrogant about what we think we are. We barely even perceive the world in an objective sense. A lot of what we see is our monkey brain evolved to show us things that help us with our survival. And that's clear as day. We don't see objective reality the way it is. Who knows what we're missing? There could be lots. And, you know, the stuff we do see, a lot of it is actually like a simplified, misinformed view of objective reality to just help us get by and do the things we need to survive. And so, you know, it's just mind-boggling that humans all around the world think they're so special. But it could be. Consciousness could be incredibly special and fundamental to the universe, but doesn't look like it.
Phenomenon is called emergence, and it's one of the most fascinating and mysterious features of our universe.
Hey, thanks, Korf.
In a nutshell, it describes small things forming bigger things that have different properties than the sum of their parts. Emergence is complexity arising from simplicity. And emergence is everywhere.
Oh, I can't wait to talk about this video because there's so much we can talk about.
Water has vastly different properties to the molecules that make it up, like the concept of wetness. Take wet fabric.
Is water wet? Can I get some answers in the chat? I need to know. Is water wet?
If you zoom in far enough, there is no wetness. There are just molecules sitting in the spaces between the atoms of the cloth. Wetness is an emerging property of water. Something new, only created by a lot of individual interactions between water molecules. And this is sort of it. Many things interact under a certain set of rules, creating something above and beyond themselves. It turns out that more is different. This different property is itself a new thing, and that new thing can couple with other new things.
So this is really getting at the whole idea of physics, in a sense. You know, what you do in physics is you break things down to the most... Well, you do lots of things, right? But one good tactic is you boil things down to the most fundamental things you can imagine with your little monkey brain, and then you build up from there. And as you build up, you'll notice that things emerge, and weird things emerge. And then when you get to as small as the quantum sort of stuff that we've known about for a while, things don't even make any sense anymore. Like, compared to our common sense that, you know, has evolved on the savannas of Africa and to be afraid of saber-tooths and things like this, it's like we just can barely comprehend what's going on down at very small scales, because it just disobeys all of our common sense. And that's why philosophy has been redundant for so long. There's some areas where it's still very important, don't get me wrong, like ethics and morality, sure. But in trying to decipher the world, how do you decipher the world with logic if it's like kind of breaking it? In a sense, it's not. Math is logic, and so that's how we decipher nature, even though this may be a flaw with math, with Gödel's theorem. But how do you make some giant leaps there without math, or without, more importantly, experimental data? Because there are some constants in nature which we can only get at if you measure. And so just trying to, we can't derive some of them. So philosophy, in a sense, is, you know, how does it keep up?
To repeat the process. You can imagine this as layers stacked upon each other, every layer made from more complex parts.
Do I believe in miracles? I think the universe is a miracle, my friend. You can either look at the world in two ways, right? As if nothing's a miracle or as if everything's a miracle. Einstein said that, and it's pretty clear that everything is a fucking miracle, because what is going on? Like, we can't comprehend it. And clearly miracles are real, right?
Atoms form molecules. Molecules form proteins. Proteins make up cells. Cells make up organs. Organs form individuals. Individuals form societies. But how can something be more than the sum of its parts?
I think a better example of this, well, not maybe better, but a fun example is like, if I was to start replacing neurons in your brain, right? Apparently, you've got about 100 billion neurons in your brain. So if I start replacing each neuron with another neuron, right? Like a replacement one, how many neurons do I have to replace before you aren't you? Right? So now, like, think about it. What are you? Is it like just a little bunch of neurons, or do you need a thousand? Do you need a million? Do you need a... Clearly, you might need 100 billion, but like, what are you of those neurons? It's just incredible to dwell on. Like, what are you? I don't think we're just neurons. We might be, though. So it's like, how does consciousness emerge? How does an internal, like, experience, this abstract experience kind of thing, that's somehow, like, continuous as well, emerge from just neurons and electrical... you know, movements, just electromagnetism, essentially, in the brain. Like, what's going on? We have no idea. So that's another fun area we need to keep exploring. Their version 2 of KelvinPN is like a day away. Mac is a few days away. And this thing has post-quantum cryptography in it, so it can protect you from quantum computers. And that's going to be really important because we just had the World Quantum Congress yesterday, and you had people like this guy who is a... an ex-CIA person saying it's the single largest economic national security issue we've ever faced as Western society. Some governments are believed to have already started stealing enemies' encrypted secrets now so they can unlock them as soon as powerful quantum computing is available. They already exist. So, you know, what better? I've created the world's first VPN that has these post-quantum algorithms, which are theoretically impenetrable by powerful quantum computers. So if you want to protect your data, feel free to come check out my little program.
Ants form the sort of cloudy entity that is a colony.
That's why the number 7 is everyone's lucky number.
By following a rule set that produces order through chaos. For example, let's look at how an ant colony distributes jobs. Let's assume that a colony should have 25% workers, 25% caretakers, 25% soldiers, and 25% gatherers. Ants communicate their current job via chemicals. For example, a worker ant constantly secretes chemicals that say, "I'm a worker." When ants meet other ants, they smell each other to gather information, telling each other their job and what they're doing. Both keep track of who they met in the past. Now, imagine an ant.
That's pretty incredible. That doesn't sound very stupid to me.
Eater kills most of the gatherers. If this isn't fixed quickly, the colony will starve. Many worker ants need to switch jobs, but how do you tell this to thousands of them? Simple, you don't. Our worker ant will still meet and smell other ants, but it will encounter almost no gatherers at all. It counts too few gatherers until it reaches a critical point, and then it changes its job. The worker becomes a gatherer. Other ants will do the same until after a while there are enough gatherers again. The balance is restored all by itself. The actions and interactions of an individual are random. You can't plan.
Anyone else just thinking about Bug's Life right now? What a fucking movie. Or Starship Troopers. It was one of the earliest sci-fis I ever watched, Starship Troopers, the big fucking bug. If you've never seen Starship Troopers...
Which ant will encounter which other ant? But the simple set of rules is so elegant that a colony's many operations emerge as a consequence. On an even more fundamental level, hundreds of millions of complicated molecules interact to maintain a robust and amazing structure. A being with vastly different properties than the sum of...
Oh, yes, ants. That little chant they do at the end. How's it go?
Its dead parts emerges. The smallest unit of life, a cell. We still don't have a clear definition of what living things are. We just know they emerge from things that are not...
Who knows? Maybe it's not the most fundamental part of life, you know? I don't think it's really correct to say that, in a sense. If you're not sure what I'm talking about, it's like, how do we define what life is? Where does it begin? Because again, like the neurons we were talking about, like, you're obviously made up of cells, right? A lot of them. So, you know, do you regard life as a cell, or do you need to go smaller? Because there are things in here which I think are verging on life as well, like the mitochondria. You know, is a virus alive? And then the border of these things as well is also not extremely clear. So defining life seems to be something we also can't do just yet. And so I think I hope this sort of touches on, you know, gives you a glimpse of how little we still actually know about pretty much all the big questions. All right. So, you know, there's a lot of people in this world who have a ginormous ego, who think we know so much, and yet we don't know what consciousness is. We don't know how it emerges. We don't know what life is. We don't know how it emerges. We don't know what the universe is. We don't know. We kind of know how it emerges from some fundamental stuff. Probably not right. So you see what I mean? There's a lot, man. Don't be too egotistical. We know so little.
It's alive. Cells combine and cooperate. They specialize and respond to one another, and over time, we develop into complex organisms with remarkable...
The music in the background is beautiful.
...capacities. Your arms and legs and heart are an incredibly complex and complicated system made of trillions of individual stupid things. And yet we breathe, digest, and watch YouTube videos. How do your cells know what to do?
If you're not having an existential crisis right now, like somewhat of one, like, what am I? You know, I don't know how we get you there, man.
Think of the pacemaker cells in your heart. Billions of them need to send out an impulse just at the right moment to collectively create a heart.
10 out of 10, little animation here.
Beat. Our cells exchange chemical information with their neighbor cells to see what they're up to and then decide what to do. If it's among a lot of cells that are working on the same task, it will start working on that task as well and sync up with them. There is no mastermind giving commands, just single units communicating with their neighbors and acting according to the feedback they get. What about our most important part? What is the thing that asks these kinds of questions?
Sorry.
Is our consciousness then an emergent?
Did he just gave like a million kids nightmares for sure.
Property of the cells in our brain. This question is too big and important. It deserves a video of its own.
Sorry for
some
that one,
things
virtual.
That emerge are hard to define. You can't touch an ant colony, only its parts. It has neither brain nor face nor body. And yet the colony interacts with the world. Just like colonies emerge from ants, things emerge from humans, like nations. What actually is a nation? Is it its population? Is it its institutions? Its symbols, like its flag?
I think a nation is easier to define, actually, than a lot of this stuff. I think another interesting thing to define, like, how something emerges is... Well, there's basically everything, right? But how the large-scale universe emerges from the small scale. It's a big open question. Like, how does general relativity emerge from quantum mechanics, quantum theory? You might be confused right now. Why? Because they're fundamentally different, right? They don't fit whatsoever. But at some scale, they have to, like, there has to be a transition from what we call the classical world, the very big, because it's not a quantum theory. Things aren't quantized. And we think that there must be a quantum theory of gravity, right? Because general relativity... we still think it's a classical theory of gravity. But at some point, at the very small scale, you've got fundamental subatomic particles happening, right? And the most subatomic we know about, the most fundamental is like these quantum fields. And so from these quantum fields, we can explain how things emerge up to a certain size. But then at what point, you know, does gravity come in? And where does the transition to the large-scale universe? We actually have no idea, right, how the large-scale universe interacts with the very small scale. Doesn't that just blow your mind? Like with all the science we've done, all the things going on, you know, we still don't understand how just like big objects, right? Like even, you know, stuff not much larger than you, how does that emerge out of atoms? It's like you might think, oh, you just piece it together, but I'm talking about the physics of it. And how do you go from you know, the quantum, you know, if you're looking at the wave function of things to looking at calculating the geodesics, or, you know, calculating Einstein's field equations, or, you know, the gravitational potential around a black hole. It's beautiful to think about. And I think not many people are aware of how little we actually know, in a sense.
Colors or anthems. The physical things it makes, like cities. The territory it occupies. All of these things are fluid. Populations change and are replaced. Institutions come and go. Cities can be constructed and abandoned. Borders have changed all the time for most of history. And symbols get replaced by new symbols. A nation has no face, no brain, no body. Are nations not real then? Of course they are. Just like ant colonies, nations interact with the world. They can change landscapes, wage wars, grow or decline, and they can stop existing. But they only exist because of a lot of humans interacting with each other. But not just nations. All the complex structures that surround us emerge from us. Even if we don't intend to, we are constantly creating communities, companies, cities, societies. All of these things are entities that have fundamentally different properties and abilities than the pretty stupid apes they emerged from. We don't know why any of this happens. We just observe it, and it seems to be a fundamental property.
I like it. So if ants are stupid, we're just pretty stupid. I can agree with that.
Of our universe. It may be the most beautiful and wondrous property of our universe.
That's that video done.